Tonight, a lost history many are just now beginning to hear about. The discovery of 215 children's bodies in a mass grave at an Indigenous boarding school in Canada this past summer sparked a reckoning with such schools here in the U.S. And as Chris Harapsky reports, that reckoning is reaching Minnesota.
This way you're growing vocabulary.
At the University of Minnesota Morris.
Minawa eketan.
Professor Gabriel DeRosier is teaching Anishinaabe Mohan, the native language of the Ojibwe people.
It was important back in traditional times to know these things.
It does not escape him that 120 years ago, on the very soil he's standing on, speaking this language was forbidden, even punished.
Cultural genocide.
He's talking about an era of Indian boarding schools, and he would know. His mother, his uncles attended them. DeRosier himself went to a Catholic day school outside his reservation in Canada, the effects of which produce childhood trauma and a broken family structure that is difficult to grasp.
She didn't really know how to express or love, and that all came from what she experienced as a child. You know, all her brothers became alcoholics, and they all died alcoholics, and tragic deaths. So.
For 100 years, dating back to the 1860s, Native American boarding schools existed in the United States. By historical accounts, they were funded by the federal government, meant to sever American Indian culture and quote-unquote civilize the Indian.
My family has two generations of boarding school history that I know of.
Christine Dindisi McCleave is the CEO of the National Native American Boarding School Healing Coalition based in Minneapolis. She explains how President Ulysses Grant gave federal money to churches at first to start these schools.
Because he figured that they would not be corrupt with those funds. And so that is what opened the door to federally funded, church-run Indian boarding schools.
In 1879, U.S. Army Captain Richard Henry Pratt established the first federally funded off-reservation Indian school in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, enrolling more than 10,000 American Indian and Alaskan Native children from more than 140 tribes. Pratt famously once said,
"They must get into the swim of American citizenship, kill the Indian in him, and save the man."
But he also created propaganda. He took before and after photos of these students to prove that his experiment worked and that the Indians could be quote-unquote civilized.
That school became a model for 16 schools in the state of Minnesota, from Pipestone to Morris to Vermilion, and at least 367 schools across the U.S., according to the Healing Coalition. Problem is, no one, not even the federal government, knows exactly how many schools there were, nor exactly how many children attended them. There is no official record. But according to the book Education for Extinction, the best estimate is that by 1926, 83% of Indian school-aged children attended boarding schools, ultimately reaching an estimated 200,000 American Indian children, according to McCleave.
There were laws that were written that said that all Indian children had to attend these boarding schools in the beginning years. If a parent chose not to let their kid go or tried to, you know, prevent them from being taken, they could be thrown in jail, and some were, or they could have rations withheld. And so they had no choice. Their children were forcibly taken.
She says conditions were often brutal.
They were given uniforms. They were given a number. They were referred to by their number only. And their hair was cut, which for many tribes across Turtle Island represents either grief or shame.
I think it depends on the era and it depends on the schools.
Dr. Kate Bean is an American Indian Studies professor at the University of Minnesota and director of Native American Initiatives at the Minnesota Historical Society. While she calls much of this era ethnic cleansing, she points out that not every school was that harsh.
My grandmother went to the Flandreau Indian School in South Dakota, and she had a wonderful experience there, learning how to farm, learning how to sew. And her experiences there as a student were very, very starkly different than my grandfather's experiences at a different boarding school in South Dakota.
Each story is different, but the atrocities shared by so many are no longer going unnoticed.
And when I look out I see that none of us have been spared.
In Minneapolis this September, a group gathered to honor and remember boarding school survivors.
I distinctly recall her saying to me directly, if I don't put you in the boarding school, they're going to take you away from me.
A march is a voice.
Put your hands up.
But a secretary in the federal government, that is power.
We must shed light on the unspoken traumas of the past, no matter how hard it will be.
Former Congresswoman Deb Haaland is now the head of the Interior Department that ran many of these schools a century earlier. Her own family attended them. And for the first time in the U.S., the federal government is investigating records, stories, archives, and eventually ground-penetrating radar to find out how many children never made it home.
Acknowledgement is the very first step. Acknowledging that this history happened. Recognizing that this history happened. Recognizing the impact on this history is the next step.